Bari, it's south of Italy, and she is teaching since 2011 landscaping architecture in Bari for around 110 students totally, so quite a lot. And she is also given lectures on history of the Near East, Northern Africa, and the Mediterranean Sea. She has made her PhD from Aleppo. It's a very interesting PhD. It's about the morphology and typology of the city, and it's going back until Roma and all these historic traces, and all these things are published in Italian and English. It's a very interesting book. She has also published a book on Medina, and she has made a lot of essays and reports in newspapers and journals and so on. Yeah, she has made her PhD, and then she has worked for MIT in Boston. She has been a postdoc, and I think we will get now a lecture concerning process typology as a tool for urban and landscape design strategies for cultural heritage sites redevelopment. Thank you very much for coming, and now I think we will have a nice lecture.
Thank you very much for your kind invitation here, first of all. And yes, this afternoon I will talk about some cities in Italy and in the Middle East, which are cultural heritage sites. And I will start from some examples in Italy, from the region I'm coming from, which is two examples. One is Matera, which is not exactly in Apulese, Basilicata, which is very close with cultural speech to the region. And the other one is Agrobaio, which is another speech. And dealing with these examples, I will try to why these cases were chosen as a work heritage site, and what we do mean with some words like heritage, like sustainability, and landscape. And then I will try to deal with some other examples, which are not in Italy but are in the Middle East, which are endangered in these years, in the last decades, and perhaps in the future. So I'm not going really to talk about strategies, because there I won't show you plans or examples of design, or so there will be a solution, of course. But dealing with this world, landscapes, stability, scales, inter scales of reference, I will try to open dialogue with you to understand if the strategies are inside or out and wider. So the first center to talk about is Matera. Almost in that part of the Mediterranean basin. So it's in between the Apulia region, which is this one. Talk about where I come from, Apulia, this Bari, on the Adriatic Sea. And Matera is a town which is in the Basilicata region, is in a region which is called Murge. It's a region where the old landscape, everything, almost everything. building. It's made by stone. It's a stone landscape with some traces of water, superficial or underground. But it's a kind of dry complex. And Matera is a city. I put it into the slide some paragraphs taken from the website of the UNESCO website to understand why this city was chosen. It is a troglodyte settlement because it was shaped into the stones. People in the past and prehistoric times, they chose this place to live in because it was the landscape to keep them. Indeed, as you can read, it was zoned for a very limited time, but the city was inhabited. Let's say, now, until now, almost continuously, because it was this is a map of the city, which is divided in some neighborhoods, but basically, you can see the typology of the structures, which is adapted to the and these are some pictures of the city church, half excavated inside the stone and half built outside. A view of the city and another picture of this. Recently, the city got very famous. After these pictures into the World Heritage Sites and after the redevelopment of the city, this got very popular, not just in Italy, but all over the world. And recently, some movies were shot. The pictures related to the Ben-Hur and to the Passion of Christ, the one directed by Gibson. So this kind of landscape, half related to the rock and half built, after this rehabilitation and this inscription into the World Heritage Site, get very famous. And in this picture, you can see one side of the city, which is the oldest one, which is almost entirely caved into rocks. And the upper you can see the other side of the city, which is more constructed. So, this is the view of the city from one of the caves. As I told you, the city basically was built by dwellings, which were half excavated into the rock and half built. They are called sassi. No? The old city center of Matera is called sassi Matera, which means the stones of Matera. Those of this. And this is a reconstruction of the plan and the kind of symmetrical construction of the city, of a traditional dwelling. So all the rooms were excavated into the side of the side of the building and open towards a courtyard. There was a courtyard which was the center of the life of the house, and the rooms were underground to the other side. But what was important for Matera was not just the typology of the houses as, kind of exotic way of living, but it was, first of all, how the city dealt with the environment, how the water was collected to give life to the city, how the rooms were arranged around the courtyard, to be warm during the winter and to be fresh during the summer. And how the city was built, putting together different layers of this housing, and so building a kind of strong relationship between the natural environment, which is even in Matera, which is not friendly in Matera. It's not a desert city, but it's very, very, very close to and how the house typology was arranged to give answer to this So this is another plan of a typical neighborhood. As you can see, there were a number of rooms arranged around this kind of hotel, which is in the middle. And people used to live into these rooms. They used to store food. And animals used to live into these rooms, together sometimes in the same rooms with inhabitants. So as you can see from this map, there were kind of boats in which animals could stay, and storage places, and sometimes people now used to live to sleep with the animals in the same place. The courtyard was not just a place where the society could be. It was first of all the place where the water could be collected through a system that collected rain into tanks and to be used during the So this is a view of the stones, the sassi. And you can, as you can see from this view, the houses were built one on top of the other. Because from one side they used, you know, the slope of the hill. From another side, this system was good to to collect water from the effect of gravity was used for this distribution of water and for climate reasons. But what happened in Matera was not something isolated from the environment, from the territorial context. This system, this hydraulic system to capture the water using the gravity, using following the slope of the hills, collecting towards walls. Our system used all over the region. So when I was talking about Puglia and Basilicata, I say, from a political point of view, are two different regions of Italy. But from regarding to the environmental context, they are the same. So what is shown to these pictures here, this is an aerial view and this is the plan, is a traditional prehistoric system to capture the water, to collect water, using the morphology of the site. So for gravity, so along the slope of the hill, the water was collected through these stone walls into some So, the techniques, the hydraulic techniques, the construction techniques which we are using in Matera are definitely widespread all over the region. So, Matera was sustainable in the past because it used some system for, to build the landscape which were somehow used all over the region. And this is a cross-section of the settlement of the Sassi. As you can see, there is a slope, terrace slope, and each terrace is one level of housing, basically, which are kept into the slope. And there are this system of stairs of pathways to connect different levels of these terraces. But as you can see from these drawings, which were not made by me, but by Pietro Laureano, who was the one who proposed the submission of the UNESCO list of the city of Neglia, who studied this hydraulic system and this typology and the construction techniques of this settlement, and proposed to install it into the UNESCO heritage list. And as you can see, these paths or these stairs are not just a system to give access to the houses, not to enter the housing and the rooms or to connect different levels. Are related to the system of capture of water, collecting it into some kind of tanks inside or outside the housing. So outside, sorry, means into this courtyard. Inside means some tanks which are related to the roof structure instead of the So in this case, in case of Matera, this term sustainability, how the city was, as I told you, was sustainable in the past. Why was it sustainable? Because people who built the city, who inhabited the city, were able to build it according to this relationship, I mean, taking into consideration this relationship between the territorial features where the city is set, and local process of transformation of resources, which are pool in Puglia in general. I'm talking about water resources and the definition of the So, starting from the people in vocation, from the characteristics, the city characteristics. But I told you that the city was almost continuously inhabited till now, because something happened in it was around 1950, when after the Second World War, somebody found out that the way in which people was living in Matera was not good. The mother was unacceptable. So living into these caves where the humidity was strong, there was no lighting and so on, was not good for people to live there. So basically in Italy a big discussion started about the condition of the site. This is the famous, most famous book written on this, not specific on this topic, but on Matera. Christus in the Marco Devoli, which means Christ stopped in Ebri, which is a city, a town northern than Matera, which means that, you know, it's very south of Italy, there was no Christianity intended as a possibility for human to live there, because they were like animals, basically this is the idea. And in which book the condition of people living in Matera were described, now with people living with animals and so on and so on. So basically the city was abandoned. No? The municipality closed the city, they built a wall to not to allow people to live there. And some new settlements were planned outside outside Matera or the some very good examples for the Italian architecture, there were competition and so on and so on. By the way, the city was expanding. And this is a picture of the city during the 1960s-70s when Pasolini went to Matera and found this ghost city. He shot a movie regarding this the life of Christ. But basically, the city started now to be to the starting from Pasolini again, and starting from you know, a group of people who said, okay, this wasn't a good place for people to live in, but we don't have to forget our heritage, because as I told you, it was not a local problem. I mean, this is a problem that sent, okay, but it was built taking into account principle of sustainability, no? Some ideas of sustainability. So what we can do to for the rehabilitation of this site? So starting from the 1980s, the Italian government started now to think about the possibility of the rehabilitation of this. So they gave money to restore Sassi, but to give infrastructure to cities, or to allow people to live there in a modern condition. And in 1993, the old city of Matera, Sassi, where it's included into the UNESCO Heritage List. Starting from that point, these are some pictures of some churches and part of the The city was restored. How it was restored? Starting from the criteria which were raised as sustainability criteria. So starting from the restoration of this kind of terraces, which are gardens, we call it productive gardens, because in the history, I mean, of the urban, in the urban history of the south of Italy, now we traditionally had this kind of gardens which were related to production of food and stuff for the inhabitants. The restoration started from the restoration of tanks and the rainwater system. And from the natural structure of ventilation, no, and control of the temperature inside the So the rehabilitation of the city started from the analysis of the reason why the city was sustainable in the past, and starting from this development. So this is a very good example for our region, because you know, starting from understanding the specific characteristics of sustainability inside the relationship between urban fabric, housing, and landscape, Matera started living there. And these are some pictures now. Basically, everything is hotel. So this is not the room for the city, but it's not just a boutique hotel, because many people from Matera, they import. It's a complex system. I don't know how to describe it or not, because I'm not so deep in it. But basically, the municipality, people who want to buy something there, they buy a part and they rent another part. So it's something, it's an economic system in which the municipality still has the kind of property, yes, control of the old city center, because they want to be sure that nothing happens and they won't destroy, I mean, the traditional characteristics of this town. By the way, many of these Sassi were transformed into particular, other are in a different way. Another example I'm going to talk about is in the same region. I don't know, maybe perhaps 50 or 60 kilometers far from Matera, so not far. It's in the Murgia, the same region. And it's again a stone settlement, because as I told you, we are not in the desert, but we are very dry. Which was settled in a region which from the antiquity, and historic times was deeply impacted. How did build this city? With this kind of housing, which are named tuli. The word tuli comes from the Greek, somehow, and it's related to the kind of form which cover the rooms. So basically, they are limestone dwellings, again, built without mortar, without drywall, for some reason. But basically, the origin of this drywall system is not, I mean, it's not sure. Somebody said, this is typical Italian, this is why it was not to pay taxes. Because people used to settle in the countryside, but when the control came, they could, demolish easily everything and then to rebuild it. Okay. I don't know if this is the real reason, but this could be one of the. They have this dome, which is conical, and it's a kind of roof, which is this picture. It's not just in, we can find it not just in El Rovello, but in all the home settlements around El Rovello. As I told you, this is this region is called Murge, but in particular around El Rovello is called Valle d'Itria, Itria Valley. And all along, yes, all along the valley, there are settlements set at 6, maximum 9 kilometers. Far one from the other. And in the middle, all the countryside is inhabited with this kind of housing. So it's something that we don't find just in El Rovello, even if El Rovello is listed into the UNESCO site. But we find this kind of construction technology all over the valley. While the site was inscribed into the World Heritage List, because they considered the exceptional example of this form of building construction derived from prehistoric construction techniques, which had survived till now. So the difference between Matera and El Rovello is that Matera Central Point, even for 30 years, it was abandoned. But in the Itria Valley, they continue not to live into this kind of topology. So this is another picture of yes, this is a prehistoric construction techniques which was used and this is a typical section of one of these buildings, this building, which is sustainable again. It's again, as in the example of Matera, the reason for the sustainability of this building construction is related to the techniques of collecting the water, which from the roof go down. Here there are some channels. Collect the water into these tanks, which are under the tanks. And the thickness of the wall from one side allowed to build, create some kind of a box inside where people used to sleep and to stay. And the thickness is the reason why this place is the roof inside are very. Place of living in the summer time and during the winter time are warm, no? Because the control, the climatic control is given by the thickness of the the water collected into the tanks was used to drink in the past and to for the governments outside the UK. So it was not a circle of sustainability given by the shape of the roof of the pulley, by the construction beams, and by this way of collecting and reuse the And these are two areas of Alberobello. The red line is the boundary of the area is starting to be massed on the side. One is named Aya Piccola, the one on the left, and the other one, Quartiere Marti, not the King's neighborhood. Again, the reason for the sustainability of Alberobello is not related just to the sustainability of the housing, no? Because the houses fully were sustainable in their economic side. But was given by the urban fabric town of Alberobello. So basically from the relationship existing between several buildings, we call it housing, we call housing basic buildings, residential buildings. But in Alberobello it's true that all the building typology were the same, no? Everything was made by Thule. Churches are Thule, palaces are Thule made by, I don't know, 10 rooms instead of two, no? Everything is based on this elementary cell, which is the square home with this conical kind of But the sustainability of this urban fabric is given by the relationship which is between all the students. No? They gave birth to what we call urban fabric type, which is the concept of coexistence, which means aggregation, the way how they are put together in relationship, the law in which they are put together, of several buildings within an homogeneous historical domain, which in the south of Italy remained the same from the prehistoric times basically to the modern times, because they were people from the countryside, they continued to live basically in the same way that we until 1970-1990. So it is the result of the specific action of what we call a civilization on a specific site. And this is the cultural landscape of this valley of the region in which Alberobello is. As you can see from this picture, everything is built in the same way. No? Alberobello is not something that exists there and there's no connection with the territorial system in which it's placed. Because all the countries are displayed by Tulli, so it's all the system, the water collecting system of the countryside are built with the same techniques, which are the same techniques of Matera. So basically they, in this way, so collecting water coming from the rain, using the slope of the lid and collecting it into this tank. These are other different kinds of wells and tanks, underground tanks, which are, you know, built with the same structure techniques of Thule. So these are dry stone walls divided in different fields and pathways around the countryside. So everything on the landscape is built in the same way, using this dry stone system, called water collecting system and architecture. So this is what I think is a cultural landscape. So it's a landscape given by an organicity of relationship between the different elements which compose a landscape. Landscape is not just a view, no? It's not just what we perceive, what we see on a specific site. landscape is, I mean, this view, image or sign, is given by, in this case, in cultural landscape, in the way how the natural environment was transformed by a specific civilization into a human environment. And in this case, in case of the Valedictia or Matera or whatever, this was built in homogeneous way, according to the same, using the same construction techniques. So and this is the Valedictia landscape. This is the landscape around Alvar Bello. Okay, this is a satellite image. But what is funny is the drawing of, on the right, which was made on in which studying the aerial pictures and cartography of 1940, okay, she found all the round shapes, you know, the circles and kind of half moon shapes, which are these, which are walls, basically, this kind of wall. And this kind of system. So on the landscape was it was possible to redraw all the territorial structure starting from the analysis and to the redraw of this system to collect the water. So all the landscape, what we see, what we don't understand, because if we see something we don't understand immediately now, why it is made in that way, was made because of this reason of sustainability and of relationship between housing, needs to collect water, and territorial reform, which is a hill region. So basically this round shape follow the contour lines. So we can define at this point landscape as a palisades, no? So the overlay of different places of different civilization who live in a specific place. So landscape is not just what you see, no? It's this, I mean, in some region of the world, of course, no? This is a continuously inhabited region, so that's why it was possible to give this definition to this. So landscape is the history formal structure, no? So it's the transformation of specific civilization of a specific natural community. So the Valedictia, the Valle, it's a territorial town. Alvar Bello is not something unique into the region, because that is a local town, that is Alvar Bello, this is a kind of factory into the countryside, it's called Masseria, and that is a picture of the landscape. Now, everything was built according to the same idea of sustainability, of construction, and so on. So we can define the territory. So Alvar Bello was inscribed into the UNESCO list. But as I told you, it's not something, you know, taken out from the context. It's something strictly related to the context, to the context. Indeed, after the inscription of Alvar Bello to this list, this part of the Puglia, this part of the south of Italy, started to be very, very, very well known all over the world. Now we call it, we don't call it anymore Valedictia, we call it Itriashire, because starting from 15 years ago, almost all the trolley were bought by people from UK. No? It became very, very, very well known. Well, everybody wants to come there to spend holidays and so on and so on. So this inscription of Alvar Bello, you know, was the point from the redevelopment of all the region. Indeed, starting from this, you know, this feels like something that starting from all 2 years ago or last year, the mayors of different towns in the Valle, they made a kind of agreement to protect not only the city centers, which are very, very, very well preserved because people continuously inhabit them there. So this is the Rocotondo, but this is not the recent restoration. The city has always been like that because people have always lived in the city. But they made the, a kind of agreement to protect the countryside because, you know, the Rovello was protected by the UNESCO. The other city centers were protected by the inhabitants. But the countryside, was going to be very, very badly transformed. So they say stop. We have to we have to control this transformation and not to cut this region into, I mean, not to turn this region as divided into the lands belonging to one town or to the other, but we have to talk all together to understand how is it possible to allow people to build, to transform according to idea to protect the landscape. Because the landscape, even if it corresponds to the regular type, even if it's something related to culture in a specific region is something very fragile, no? Because if we don't take care, if we don't listen not the needs of sustainability of specific landscape, we can destroy it very, very, very easily. So they are starting doing this. So the UNESCO was good to be not the starting point for and even to the inhabitants, to let them know how important it was the heritage, no? Because I come from the town over there, so that's why I'm I used to live there since I was 15 years old, and then we moved to Dubai. But I remember that when I was a child, to live in Truli was very bad. No? It was related to the country inside people, and I remember I was a child and I asked my mother, Mama, why don't we buy Truli? It's nice. I said, no, it's impossible, no, because it was very bad. But the UNESCO gave the possibility to people instead to understand how important was the heritage, no? And starting from this, starting from people who came from abroad and people from UK, they wanted to buy Truli. Everybody there started to understand the richness of the landscape. So this was. But we were, I'll just dealt with some cases in Italy, which are for the moment not in danger or forever. And but the situation of heritage and cultural heritage all over the Mediterranean region is not all over like that. There are some sites which unfortunately are in danger. So these are sites listed by the UNESCO. And but they are just listed and protected. But sometimes, if we think about these places, not at a specific scale, but in the complex of the relationship which made it sustainable in the past, perhaps we have to admit that the UNESCO protection practice is not enough. And this is the case of three places in the Middle East. It's very complicated to use names. West Bank, Israel, whatever it is. We have some reference for some terms, but the political situation is very complicated. Which are the Church of Nativity in and the pilgrimage route in Bethlehem? Land of Ola, yes, olives and wines in Matir, which is a few kilometers far from Bethlehem, and the old city of Jerusalem. Here there are some pictures of the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem, which is protected now by UNESCO. It was inscribed because of the reason we are reading. For its history, for the importance that it has for not just for the Christianity, but for all the religions or the Muslims. And here there is a map of the area inside the city of Bethlehem, which is protected by UNESCO. So basically it's one street and a church. So it should be South Street and another one. Okay, starting from this inscription, something started happening in Bethlehem because the municipality started with some program of rehabilitation of the area, not just the street, but neighborhood. And they started with work of architectural surveys and renovation of some neighborhoods with the help of the UNESCO, with the help of Japan, and other countries, Sweden, for example, and so on. And there was this work of this is the area of the land of olives, which is, I don't know how many kilometers, but it could be, I don't know, 10 kilometers from a little bit more, perhaps 15, from the land. This is the picture of this area. It's a terrace landscape with agriculture and settlement, which basically remained the same in the last 20 years. But what is the risk? The risk is this. This is the, the political situation, which is that political situation. I mean, this is something that we have to understand. So, Batil was preserved by the UNESCO because they want to have an image of how the landscape of the region was before, I don't know, last 100 years, let's say, because it's but all the area around Batil has been transformed into this, and into this, because of the settlements, no? Because people need to live somewhere, but they need to go away. Place for them. So perhaps UNESCO was good to preserve this region, but the strategy is not at that scale, no? It's like the Paleolithia, the strategy is not under Bellos one single fullo or in Matera one single house. The strategy is to work on a wider and wider different scale. And the problem is this, because of the territories, the fight, and this was Palestine in 1920, and that is now the West Bank, where the green spot, not all over, is connected, and so on. So it's a political problem. But perhaps the strategy is into the territorial structure. So in the necessity to not to work on the plan, not to work on Batir, but to work on the rehabilitation of area. I know this is impossible at this moment, I'm talking about just fantasy or something. But this is the strategy, no? It's not to, to preserve something like, inside a box, but to understand, to study these are works of our students, like school, which are some drawings of the final degree, which was on another small town here, but this is the strategy, not to look at the morphology of places, to look at the hydrography. geographical sources to look at the roots which historically made up this landscape and start from that to the rehabilitation of this area. So this is what we call interpretation. No? So starting from an interstellar analysis of the and understand how the interaction between the actions between the natural and human environment. These are some analyses of the integral structure of the Einstein, starting from the prehistoric times till nowadays, to understand how, why the territory was centered in that specific way. So starting the, you know, how the and why particular ground is the other problem which opens another scale, the other side which opens other scales of problems and approaches is the site of Jerusalem. Useless to spend words about Jerusalem, its history and whatever, I don't think it's the old city of Jerusalem was inscribed for its importance, say, into the world heritage list. But, and these are, you know, a map of this area and an area. But different layers of the old city of Jerusalem have different structure and different problems. That the city is basically, the old city is basically divided in four areas. Each one in reality belongs to different religions. No? There is the Christian area, the Muslim Palestinian area of water, the Jewish and the yeah. As this is the Palestinian neighborhoods. So UNESCO say, okay, we have to. But in a region, in a city like Jerusalem, where there are so strong political issues, problems, in reality, the UNESCO protection is just a formula. I mean, they can, nobody can do anything there. Nobody cannot do anything. The Israeli cannot. Sometimes they do, but now they try to avoid this interference of Israeli and so everything is kind of frozen from cultural and protection point of view, but there are some problems inside because Palestinian needs to live there because they have a kind of status if they live in East Jerusalem, so they need to stay there to travel and to have the residence there. And how they can live? They are living there transforming the urban fabric. So what is a political problem, an heritage problem? In Jerusalem, it's a typological problem also. Perhaps it's the less important, but it is from an architectural point of view, it is a problem. Because basically, they transform the courtyard houses, which are not courtyard houses anymore. They build inside the courtyard to have new rooms, to allow people to live there. And in some cases, like this one, they're doing things like that, so they build one store on the other, so there are four stores of the courtyard houses. It's not anymore something like a skyscraper, I don't know, something similar. It's interesting, but this is true, not just the problem. So officially there is protection, but in the reality, in conflict areas, I mean, there is a humanitarian program of the new and this is something that is happened even to the non-residential buildings. up to Ribaz, which are near the Aram Sharif, which were transformed into settlements. And this is what happened in the last 10 years, I guess, because we met some architectural surveys in 1999 in Jerusalem, and there were almost still courtyard houses and something. And after the second Intifada, the situation uncontrolled. And this is what happened. So this is not also a typological problem, because we cannot talk about restoration about these places. We have to get into this process and understand how the city is changing from a non-typological, morphological point of view, starting from this. So, as I told you, this is a question of process typology. We understand how buildings are changing over time, because not they coexist, but they have an antecedent. They have something which is before them, no? And they are changed by people according with their needs, with their habits, no? And it's something not typology, something not frozen in time. It's something that changes according to this. And in places like Jerusalem, it changed a lot. Now in Matera, there was no changing of typology, because the society remained the same, because there were no regional problems, and the value of the people is the same. But in places like this, like Jerusalem, we have to deal with typology and to understand if we want to, I mean, to work in continuity with this process or in discontinuity. Discontinuity could be a restoration. Now we take everything off and we go back to 19, or I don't know which year, no? Before the transformation. Continuity means that we are dealing now with this problem. We don't have courtyard houses anymore. So what we can do now? No? What kind of new types, new house types can we develop? And last case, I'm sorry, because I'm going to finish in 2 or 3 minutes, is the ancient city of Aleppo in Syria. And I think you already discussed about Aleppo, perhaps you know anything from the news or what is happening in Syria, not just in Aleppo, but list of heritage sites, but not just for the heritage sites, because in my opinion, personal opinion, there is no difference between Aleppo or Hama, no? Even if Hama is not the world heritage site, but the same is happening all over the world. It's a tragedy. By the way, the city was continually inhabited till now, no? From the second millennium BC to now. And these are the reasons why the World Heritage, UNESCO, decided to add the Aleppo to this list. Again, this is an image of the citadel. And you know, the skyline of the city. So the city has valuable monuments, but it's very, very, very important house typology, not for your houses. So again, it's not just a problem to protect some monuments, but it's, the question is how to protect or to think about possibilities, possible. I don't want to use the solution because it doesn't make sense now, and, but to think, no? And the future and the possibility to start with the redevelopment. Some images of the continuity of places. This is on the left, it's a detail of the Roman arch with, at the end of the Roman state, which was transformed into a mosque. And that is the which was the Wuhan Basilica, and the Maya Mosque, which was pictures of the destruction. But I know you already saw these pictures. So, this is the architectural service of a neighborhood of houses in Ayaba, which was made by some students at the School of Architecture of Mali. It was in 2004 or 2005. And so this is the neighborhood, how we neighborhood courtyard houses with some mosque inside, some public buildings and shops. And these are some of the service that they give of these beautiful houses and buildings. Okay. This is a study that we did about the house typology. It's something related to a methodological approach, something that was done before the war started, so made my knowledge to understand. The student had to make a project of design into the city area. So now we studied the building typologies, urban morphologies, and so on, how to understand how the urban structure was. These are some drawings related to the entrances of the houses, if they were direct from the street or if there were some rooms in between. And in the middle, there was a kind of reconstruction of the formation of the housing, because in Aleppo, the houses are courtyard. The courtyard house type is an oriented type, no? It's an oriented typology. It means that the built area inside the courtyard is oriented toward the it depends on the region. In north of Europe, like Italy is oriented toward east. My region is oriented toward southeast. In Aleppo is oriented toward west because it's the best climate condition. So this was a studio and an analysis that they did on how the rooms were oriented towards what and why, and the specialization of the rooms, which were some complex rooms shaped in van and so on and so on. And these are some analyses on the origin of the urban structure and on the structure of the courtyards, how it is arranged. All the ones in Aleppo are oriented toward north for climate reasons. So these are the red rooms into the these two maps. And there are the specialized rooms like which are not oriented because they are winter reception rooms, so they don't need to have this relationship with the climate. And these are some, this last picture, and there are some drawings the student did about this project he did of a new neighborhood in an open, what it was in an empty area. But what it, I wanted to show, this is why I'm showing you this, it's related to the approach that they had. They started working with this idea of continuity. Continuity means to study, to analyze building typology, urban morphology, and deal with that. So be in the same process, now starting to understand how building work and how the urban fabric was formed during the millennium in this case, and to start a project according with this process. So design a this is, I mean, the definition I want to give to this presentation is related to cultural identity. And if we want to design sustainable development of the urban landscape or territorial, as we were talking about the resource, for example, some cases of them and the West Bank area, has to be designed in continuity with built and natural environment. So in continuity with history, in continuity with the specific sites in which. So this is this should be the wish from my side for future approaches to the development of these places that for sure will be. We don't know when, but we know that in the future somebody will take care of this center. And the wish is that the design will be in continuity to somehow to enrich the cultural identity of these places and not to delete the sustainability of these places. Because even in Aleppo, no, the sustainability of the city was driven by the relationship between the structure of the urban fabric, the building typology, and the territorial model. So this is what I wanted to say at the end of this presentation, not to wish that not just in the UNESCO World Heritage site visited by the UNESCO, but in all the centers on all these places which are in danger in this field, the future will be sustainable and continuity will be fast. Okay, thank you very much for your
queen in this area, And the city, this boutique city, is embedded in a palmery, in a wonderful oasis. And also the resources of water and water supply was caused the city has to be located there. It was, from the Silk Road, very important to stay there, to get water, to sell the goods, and to transfer to the Mediterranean. Okay.
It's the same route that the Isis is following.
It's the same.
All territorial route that
means. The participant question. Okay, I only want to explain very quick. So it was a unit. The historic site and the environment. The kind of the source. I was in there. You could swim there. Now it's dry. They have to the hotel. Good. Also in under the French mandate, they have protected the whole area. Yeah, the site itself and the boundary. And the French has located the people. They have settled in the temple. And they located them and give them a new settlement. It's very interesting what happens there. And now it's a little town of 60,000 inhabitants. And I have worked for AU in this project and for governments and about missings. And they said, okay, if you want to do something for tourism and so on, you have to look also for the town. And then, okay, also an approach, and we had a lot of discussions with the Ministry of Tourism, because the Ministry of Tourism want to build hotels into the Palmer. The best location for tourism. We had a lot of fights, and we said again, there's also a citadel on top of the hills, it's a wonderful landscape, and we said, this has to be kept. There is no building. Okay, a lot of maps, wonderful maps that show it. Nobody takes care. Yeah? Except, okay, UNESCO has to do something, UNESCO has to do nothing. Didn't do nothing. Yeah? They have written a letter. Because it was sold area on the mountains, by all these rich people from Syria, politicians, and they could do nothing. So it's UNESCO is, as it was a lot of critics to UNESCO, I think it's very helpful to give this, it's a cultural website, but they can up to the legs. They are showing it in the. And I think now, for that, we have this definition cultural heritage sites and natural heritage. But the natural heritage sites are really, for example, caves in Africa, you know, painted or the Yellowstone Tower, something like this, yeah? But this combination, I think they are thinking of this now, that all these categories have to come together, yeah? But it's really very, very hard. And we have shown it. Also, if it's not coming from the local government, yeah? If they want to build houses, for example, in Nepal, yeah? What happens in the surrounding of Kathmandu? The whole area is built up with finger houses. So I think it's very, very important to think about this interaction between settlement and landscape. I have a lot of examples, I don't want to express it now. Oman is another example, very important. Yeah? I think we can learn from traditional architecture, landscape protection, on sustainability. Yeah? In all parts of the world, not only in Italy. It's the same in Nepal, or it's the same in Latin America, or somewhere else, in Africa, yeah. And I think this is perhaps because it's the image of the country. country sometimes. And it's the value of the country for tourism also.
And
sorry.
I think this is quite important. What is the motivation besides, you know, the aspect of maintaining something which has historical value, but with all these pressures politically and interests which come in, that one needs to ensure that there is aspects which make it interesting out of other factors why to maintain it. And I think they all have roots in contexts where we had to be much more resource sensible than we at the moment are, but we have to return to that. So there's a lot of learning in that. I think from all the examples you gave, there's a lot of we can learn for today.
Well, for me, it's one question in Matera.
Also, sometimes very interesting to know how these kind of sites would evolve if we don't freeze them.
No, I'm not talking about freezing.
Yeah, for example, of Jerusalem, I think it's very, it's a honest image of how the situation is there to see these kind of courtyards built, and it's a honest interpretation of the context. Could be in, I don't know, 30, 40, or 100 years, an image that people would see as a true sustainability in that, because people kept living in these kind of tiny spaces and they sustained their lives.
And I think that's what Annette outlined before. You never know what time you want to freeze. So maybe you would say that there came another kind of influence and they had to react to this. But I think with that kind of analysis of what is actually the underlying sustainability of that settlement, and if that is basically being attacked through basically, I mean, the courtyard system has a logic. So if you basically destroy that logic, will it be sustainable? That's the question. And not only about preserving the image of it's nice to have a courtyard, but the sustainability of the whole settlement.
But why should it be sustainable if it's you can't live in it anyway? I mean, that's my point. There is another priority beyond sustainability in that case. Sustainability comes...
But that priority is almost unsustainable, because if there are houses in which one home will be or one house, not for people and so on, yes, they need to live there. So there is it's necessary for them to and the only solution there is to build up and up and up. So we have to deal with this. But at a certain point, perhaps it won't be sustainable anymore.
I think you are right. Yeah? There's another perception of sustainability. If you say, okay, I don't take care on the cultural heritage in this way of how it looks. It's nice, it's very interesting. Courtyard houses, love typology, but here you have a living room or living space for a lot of people. Yeah, this is what you mean for sustainability. But it's clear if it's too much people living in one square, it's not anymore sustainable. But I think this sustainability is also in the tradition. We have discussed in the morning how we can, or how should be a kind of reconstruction for Aleppo, for the whole city of Aleppo. Yeah? We have this courtyard process. It was a good solution. I think it was also regulation that they cannot go too much high. Is this possibility to say you have to reconstruct in this way, or shall you destroy this old fabric or this traditional fabric and build a new typology? I think it's more sustainable to follow up this kind of of typology, but not tradition. This is a question. We have in our cities, we have also this break.
And you have the same session.
Yeah.
After the war, and so
you have to support people coming by, not this by, to have a room for life. What do you think? It's a question to you. No answer.
Oh, yes, I think I wanted to have the opportunity to ask you. Last week we went to Berlin, and there's a very strange example of this attempt to renovate things that don't exist anymore. So the discussion is
the
football forum.
Okay.
So what do you think about it? What do you think about it? Worth 500 million euros for reconstruct something that they are struggling to know how it looked like, because there is no any registers or anything, or it's better to go on and design anything else.
that is very prestigious project in Italy, I guess. This name was for vertical or something like that. And they are incorporating the same courtyard effect, but in skyscrapers. And it's not like a courtyard, but it's more like a courtyard attached to the building, but they are achieving the same effect, what the cooling of air and acting as a sound barrier and all those things, but in a modern way, I can say. So when we try to amalgamate
sustainability.
Yeah, when we try to amalgamate something from past and we kind of put in a future techniques, then I think it was more better.
Okay, this is I think it's sustainability or to have new technologies, sustainable new technologies. But when we discuss our cultural heritage on the past, do you think the past has something to do with the identity of people? Do you think?
Yeah.
Sometimes I don't believe.
It has to do something with the identity because that's how these places are still like that. Like there's some place in Italy or there's some place in India or there's some place in Nepal. Otherwise, if we try to kind of convert each and everything in an urban agglomeration, then everything will be lost and you won't be knowing these cities as their identity, why they were famous for that. Like rainwater harvesting, maybe like I know Rajasthan in India, they are very famous for rainwater harvesting. Throughout, I guess, in the world also, their techniques and their technologies are still surviving in today's state also. Like they are still using the same
methods. So you think you have to protect them?
Yeah, you have to protect them, but at the same time, we have to kind of make some balance. We cannot kind of protect the whole place or something just because they are heritage. And we need to somehow make some intervention to keep that sustainability concept with that heritage, but as well as to, least where urban things is happening, because you cannot just protect the whole area and keep it as it is, like as it was 500 years ago or something like that.
And what do you think about this interaction between heritage, cultural heritage sites, locations, settlements, and the landscape? Do you think it's important or it's not important?
I think it is important in some cases. The example which you gave for battery, because I studied in last semester a little bit about battery because they were very famous about their olive cultivation, and I think it's still the same. They were one of the hubs for vegetables and all in the whole Palestine area, and they were also famous about their springs, water springs and all for that reason. So, those kind of landscape which is still, you can use something out of it because they still kind of produce olives and it still support economic. Because these days, I think supporting these kind of sites is also very important. You cannot just survive the whole city because you are getting some revenue out of the tourism. That's one of the questions I think when UNESCO kind of see that what is the possibility out of revenue generation, because these sites has to kind of sustain itself in terms of revenues and all. So if you are getting something out of these cultural landscapes,
everywhere
balance. Yeah, you need a balance.
Doesn't have a meaning for the people. But if they interact with the site, they're, I don't know, they had a trip or something wrong, it would have a meaning for them. So they would get concerned about it and present it with something wrong. This is the third point.
I think that we are a little bit in the same target to say, okay, if you don't speak about the historic monument, like a church or a castle, but concerning your own fabric, yeah, if it's courtyard houses or another fabric, it should be a museum, it should be continuously inhabited. Isn't right?
Yeah.
Yeah? And then it's also a kind of sustainability, isn't it?
Yes.
I think so. And then it's changing. But a person can change in this continuity.
Yeah.
Yeah, so as we have seen, first it's a continuity in Jerusalem.
I think it is interesting that a few points are very important to mention because they don't clarify a few things. First of all, unlike many historical sites in the world, usually historical sites, they suffer from losing population. People, they pull out sleep. In Jerusalem, we have a population increase. And this is a big problem. Because you have an increase, you have a limited site, and you want to get more. So can they come up with a solution, chaotic solution, let's say, which are, for example, let's build more floors, let's build, you know, use more courtyards and more rooms. This is one point. And another point is that, for example, regarding the typology, new typologies, which is included. Also, we know that in the research we have, it is kind of a mixture of many identities. We find that, like, for example, the Armenian living there. And there were the Moroccan quarter, we have from Africa, we have from Syria, from many places, because of this religious and any other importance to it. So it has a mixture. But the thing is that many of these who are coming here, they are trying to preserve their original identity and try to reflect it from the city. So you get to a point where you find a new identity, which is a mixture of many identities.
Yeah, this is a process, not what we call process.
It is a process.
It is a process that perhaps Jerusalem is a focus that happens perhaps all over the world. Because we become more and more mixture. Yeah, and then it's very interesting. And I think this is really also a cultural error, it's also a cultural notice. Do we want to have integration? So we mix the Armenians with the Jewish or whatever. Or we say, okay, we have not ghettos but clusters. Like in New York, for example, you have a Chinatown, and you have this town, and this town. So, this is a question, I don't know, I have no answer.
From my point of
view, yeah.
From my point of view, this new identity, let's say, there are no problems as they don't cause kind of distortion in the original city. Because then you get to a point, for example, you get a place with another place with a different typology, another one with a third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and then it will be looking like a mess, not a developing city, because it's a mixture of things.
Next question, again, I don't want to know.
I have two questions regarding the Italy, one in the city of Vienna. You mentioned that there were a time when they built a wall and the city was not as inhabited. And I wanted to ask how they convinced people to come back to the city. Because they told them that, okay, and the situation there is not good, so you need to leave. And then they have taken a wall, and then suddenly they said, okay, we want to go to better place,
after the speech and the after rehabilitation, I mean the one of the first who came back to Sassi was the architect who proposed that Matera should become a national park. And so his house was a kind of experiment using reliving inside the city. And after this description and with some funding given by the municipality, who gave money to people to go there and to, you know, support it, even they started coming back to live, to store. So it was from one side the financial support, and from the other side was, you know, the cultural debate, which
because people went back to the city, I think there are like maybe workers there, with your medical high classes. And were they the ones responsible for the maintenance, or it was the government of the UNESCO?
And there is a mixed structure, because they have the, but the entire property just on a percentage of the house and the other remains in the
so I think the government has a kind of, you can do something, but in the same time it's private property. So they can have an influence. For example, they can say we cannot restore it this way and restore it this way. We want to keep it in this way. Yeah, but this is perhaps, yeah, it's the case with Matera. I think we can not do it all over the world and stuff. And I think, yeah, this was also my question. It's more for tourism.
Yeah, but I mean, these are cases, I mean, I'm not at all part of cases, because Adorabello has almost the same problem on because many truly was transported to shops and hotels and so on. So if all over the region people still live into truly, but not in the real world, but it's a kind of Disney world, I don't know how to say, from some non-transformed points of view. Because no, even if in the countryside or in the other small towns, people are still living. This is not true for Anurbaro, which is the one we have to be in myself. So maybe it's a shock.
Is that change is part of the human nature? I mean, should we also accept it as a being in the urban heritage site? I mean, if we look at the nature, we live aside, then you have different kind of plants, eventually you have a tree, then you have a disaster, and the life circle starts again. And this process of change, can it be part of also the human nature? Because every example we hear that the cultural exercises, there's always changing and rebuilding. And because if it was not rebuilt, then it became of a high value, then people don't live anymore. So it's always changing.
It's changing, but we have to learn how it is changing and why it is changing. And that we perhaps make this change in a kind of continuity. And that we don't make a total differencing, which is not accepted. Or it will be, at the end, it will be accepted, because people have no other chance. Yeah. But it's also my opinion, but we have another one. But to work also as an architect or development and enhanced continuity. This is a philosophy. Okay, you have to work in, yeah, you are a part of history. Yeah? We had last week a discussion on a diploma. It was on Warsaw. Warsaw was rebuilt after the Second World War. I'll show you some pictures. It was totally destroyed. Only in the middle was this gift then from the Soviets, this monument or building or whatever it was, yeah? And then it's the same discussion as we had in Berlin. The students have taken it into, they have taken it into consideration. They've made a nice fabric in the surrounding. And one of the professors said, oh, why you have kept it? And raised it. And I said, but it's history. I said, oh, history, okay. Yeah? So it's, there are different approaches. Yeah? But I think, it's my opinion as an architect, or a urban planner, you have to work in a continuity and you have to understand it. I think this is the most important. You have to know why it is. And if you, and I think this is also very important to learn about history and to combine it with architecture or development. And you can understand why it is this shape like this. Why we have it growing under the limit. Why? You know? It's nice. In Berlin, it's nice. Why? Yeah, all these things are very important, in my opinion, to understand more about society. But perhaps you have another approach and say, okay, we are a new, modern country, and we want to have new technologies. It's also an approach. Yeah. You said we want to have balance. Okay. I think we have not one solution. I think we have to, perhaps we have to build our own mind, or, isn't it? And you have to, it's not one idea. Or, what do you think? Well, you have spoken so much. The girls, what do you think? Yeah. Women are more for continuity.
Well, I find really interesting what you said about an understanding of the concept of type system and urban fabric type, but also like if you take not the landscape but just something environmentally, so, but also from the historical part of the landscape as a perception that the people pass your place. In that sense, it's very interesting what you say about urban metal, that the architecture in this case, or the urban planning, should coexist with the historical former settlements that were there, so we can develop a, maybe a better plan, also what you were saying now. I think in that case, the interpretation is crucial for developing new ideas, but not erasing what it was before, but taking into consideration all those ideas that I thought, for example, the one from Madeira, and as the sustainable part, it was really interesting what they were doing with the landscape and the landfilling and everything, but if we don't learn about it and we don't understand why they were making it like that, we'll just throw it out and something over. So in that case, as in my opinion, the interpretation is crucial for us as a government planner as well.
That's world interpretation.
This is a society.
construction that they are really living in a ghetto. It's a ghetto. Tina, what do you think about reconstruction of Aleppo? Do you think it needs a continuity or it doesn't need?
Of course. I believe it started
with that. Can you
tell me? I believe it started. It was going. But the continuity and not only maintaining it, preserving it for tourism. Because people are still enacting the whole soups, for example. People are living next to their business places. And I believe in continuity to a degree, so you have the quantity, you have the results.
Okay, and I think Herb's hotel was the typology. It could be very well adapted to the social conditions of the people. If they are poor, they have one room. Or if they are rich, they have perhaps more. Or if it's destroyed, they can build another room. So I think it's a good adaptation. But perhaps all housing typologies can be adapted and reused according to the conditions of the family or of the social conditions. For example, in Eichhorn, the example of the big system, was the socialist typology for stories. We had 36 square meters or 48. And now, in the capitalism area, now you take over the open space, you make privatization, you combine apartments. Also in Berlin, you have this process. So perhaps all the time, people is changing and adapting to their conditions.
In south of Italy, this happened because in the very past, during the Roman times, the beginning of the Middle Age, there were agricultural houses. But after, due to some social climate and cultural and rural condition, people changed house typology and they start to split this courtyard into different houses and to have more levels. And we had new typology. So our medieval cities are not courtyard houses cities, but are, we call it pseudo row house building. By the way, it's monocellular housing, no? One store on the other. This is the medieval typology of our cities. But we're built on the basis of proper houses. And when this typology was became common, very common, they start building with this typology and then, until nowadays. In some other regions, for cultural, social, and local condition, because of climate, because of everything, they kept on with these houses. So, I don't know, perhaps, Jerusalem is important from my personal point of view for this reason. Because there is a political problem. They have a huge problem, People need to live there. They don't want to go out from the problem. So they are changing. But Jerusalem is important because there something is very, very, very accelerated as a process. So what it happened in Italy in 300 years, that is happening in 15 years, 20 years. So there are some moments in
in the history of a specific place, where some process accelerate because of the history. So anything can change. I don't want to say that everything must be kept frozen. No, perhaps in Aleppo something will change. I don't know. No, I don't know if it will change or if I mean, cordial houses to me is sustainable in your city, but they need to be updated. Yes, somehow. No, with
what has somebody from Dubai, they may want to make an investment and they will build Dubai station.
Yes, but do you remember in Aleppo when they were in Capitals and they built new roads into your city, they built on site 7-6 floor buildings and they create problems with cultural houses because from the upper floor it was possible to see in courtyard and so on. So if you build skyscrapers, you create problems in the other authority. So this is why we have to now think in yes, continuity, and we need to analyze, and this interpretation means this, no? So it's what we understand from the existing building fabric and what we want to propose, no? Taking into account all the different scales of reference, which are not just the buildings, the fabric, the structure.
Okay. Another comment? Can I try that?
Sure, I have an example of interpretation. It's not architect or letter interpretation. For example, in the beginning of the building, the typology is the courtyard houses. And when people left the Medina, they, after the colonization of the French, and they started building villas, normal houses, and with the gardens and everything. The architects designed normal houses, flat roofs, and then normal modern houses. But then, after 2-3 years, people who used to live in this typology of courtyard houses, they transported all the features nearly, but not like the aesthetical, but just the typology. So they built, for example, an exterior kitchen, and then an exterior garage, and then an exterior room for storing things, and everything was like the courtyard was there, but not visible as the courtyard in the beginning, but the typology of how they lived